look at the ways in which a ragtag group of disciples, ragtag group of folks, heard the message of Jesus, were arrested and compelled by that message, and launched a worldwide Jesus revolution. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
And we want to imagine, what does it mean for us to do the exact same thing? The title of today's sermon will be Four Ways to Make Christ Known. And this is just as we're winding down our Revolutionary Living series, I want to submit to you one of the greatest assignments of the church is to make Christ known. And here in the book of Acts, we see that a small number of people were able to take their experience with Christ and actually take that to places that were out of people's imagination. We see that the book of Acts is largely considered Luke part 2, the Gospel of Luke, written by a physician by the name of Luke, who took all of the great manuscripts and early accounts of the work and the life of Jesus and coupled that with eyewitness testimony from folks like Peter, who walked with Jesus, folks like Paul, who spent time in early Jerusalem and then did all this great ministry. He took all of these records and he put it in a book called the Acts of the Apostles. And we saw at the beginning of this book that the Holy Spirit came upon everybody who was available to receive the Holy Spirit. How many of you are glad that the Holy Spirit does not discriminate? Amen. That the Spirit is for everybody. Somebody say everybody.
Everybody.
And whoever would receive this Spirit will be empowered to be witnesses. Now, it's so important to appreciate that the witnesses that we are to become are not to be Secret Service witnesses. You know, like you in, what happened when they put you in protective custody? When you gotta, you know, when they relocate you, they give you a new identity and don't nobody know where you at, don't nobody know your real identity? Witness protection, thank you. Praise God, I'm just sleepy, praise God, I'm tired. Brain ain't working half right. Witness protection program. How many of you know that the disciples of Jesus are not in the witness protection program? Amen. But we should be almost as bold and audacious as Paul is in this chapter. And I'm not going to read the whole chapter, but I'm going to just give you an example of how bold and audacious Paul and the homies were when they were going through this chapter. Listen, in verse number 6, it says that when they could not find Paul and Silas, they dragged Jason and some of the believers before the city authorities, shouting, "These people have been turning the world upside down. And now they showed up to our city." It just makes me ask the question, what do people say when you show up? Praise God. They like, oh, thank God that we got these witness protection revolutionary followers of Jesus. Or folks like, oh my goodness, here you come. Trying to turn thing upside down. Because how many of you know when God comes into your life, things don't stay the same?
Amen.
Amen. You give God some time and we create some openness and God begins to do something great. So Acts chapter 17, we're going to hang out here. We're going to start in verse number 16. And we'll spend a good chunk of time, amen, preaching on four ways to make Christ known. When you have to say, I got it?
I got it.
All right. Come along with us, amen. I want to read this half of the chapter because I think it's some not only great material, but it's going to give us a wonderful context for how we may experience the word of the Lord. While Paul was waiting for them, and the them he's talking about is Silas and Timothy, he was waiting for them in Athens, Greece. Everybody heard of Athens, right? Athens, Greece. So this is in the country of Greece. He was deeply distressed to see that the city was full of idols. So he argued in the synagogue with the Jews and the devout persons, and also in the marketplace every day with those who happened to be there. And also some Epicurean and Stoic philosophers debated with him. Some said, "What does this babbler want to say?" Others said, "He seems to be a proclaimer of foreign deities." And let me park right there this is not just a, you know, kind of neutral accusation. About 500 years previous to this actual moment in time, a guy by the name of Socrates. Anyone heard of the guy named Socrates, right? Socrates and Plato and all them smart folk. Well, Socrates, in this exact same geographical area, 500 years previous, was charged with the exact same thing, and they killed him. So to be, you know, like accused of being a babbler and proclaimer of foreign deities is not just about you talking too much. But Paul was actually putting himself at risk by proclaiming, as the scripture goes on to say, the good news about Jesus and the resurrection. So they took him and brought him to Areopagus, and they asked him, may we know what this new teaching is that you are presenting? It sounds rather strange to us. So we would like to know what it means. Now all the Athenians and the foreigners living there would spend their time in nothing but telling or hearing something new. And then Paul stood in front of the Areopagus and said, Athenians, I see how extremely religious you are in every way. For as I went through the city and looked carefully at the objects of your worship, I found among them an altar with the inscription, to an unknown God. What therefore you worship as unknown, this I proclaim to you, that the God who made the world and everything in it, he who is Lord of heaven and earth, does not live in shrines made by human hands. That's why we say here at the Way, we don't go to church, we are what? We are the church, amen. God don't live in this building, God lives in you, and God lives in me. Nor is he served by human hands as though he needed anything, since he himself gives to our mortals life and breath and all things. From one ancestor he made all nations to inhabit the whole earth, and he allotted the times of their existence and the boundaries of the places where they would live, so that they would search for God, and perhaps grope for him and find him, though indeed he is not far from each one of us. Verse 28 says, for in him we live and move and have our being, as even some of your own poets have said, for we too are his offspring. Since we are God's offspring, we ought not to think that the deity is like gold or silver or stone, an image formed by the art and imagination of mortals. While God has overlooked the times of human ignorance, now he commands all people everywhere to repent. Meaning that there was a time in our life that God, you know, kind of said, you just don't know. But now God is saying everybody needs to know. God's not going to overlook our ignorance. He's calling for everyone to repent. Why? Because he has fixed a day on which he will have the world judged in righteousness by a man whom he has appointed, and of this he has given assurance to all by raising him from the dead. Of course, they're talking about Jesus. Now, verse 32, so when they heard of the resurrection of the dead, some scoffed, but others said, we will hear you again about this. And at that point, Paul left them, but some of them joined him and became believers, including Dionysius and Areopagite and a woman named Damaris, and others with him. This is the word of God for the people of God. Let us say thanks be to God. Amen. So we're going to speak again from the topic, four ways to make Christ known. Bow your heads with me. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for the word of God that has been read for us, the people of God. We ask you to hide this word in our hearts so we will not sin against you. Please send your anointing that makes preaching and teaching easy. Let it rest upon me and even the hearers of this word. In Jesus' name we pray. Let the people of God say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Give your neighbor a high five and tell him, make Christ known. Make Christ known. Now, it is obvious that we are always living in a time, or at least aware of opportunities presented before us about the possibility of how do we make known to those who don't know what they need to know. Now we know that's an art, praise God. Most people go to school to learn how to teach, because teaching, helping people to understand what they don't know, requires a system, and it requires a skill set, it certainly does require some kind of a knowledge that is attainable, that is not above or beyond people's comprehension. And we believe, certainly as followers of Jesus, as people who have had this radical introduction to the Lord, that God is not trying to remain unknown to the world. How many of you know that God would love for all of us to be known, or God would love for everyone in the world to know who God is? And many of the times, God does not pop up on people's Twitter feed or on your Instagram account. God don't show up knocking on your front door. Most of the time, God will show up through his church, through those who are followers of Jesus. And one of the great tasks that I find in front of us, particularly given the kind of culture and society we live in, a culture that is post-Christian, moving towards a post-religious, post-religion culture, is what does it mean for us to take seriously living our lives in such a revolutionary way that it stands out as a compelling way of existence? What does it mean for you and I to embrace and appreciate that how we live matters? How you treat folk matters? How you are aware of the work of God in your own life matters? And what is at risk when we don't make Christ known is that there will be many people who spend their lives worshiping idols that are unable to give them what they need. Hello, somebody. I mean, that's what an idol is at the end of the day. An idol is a wannabe God. An idol is a God with a small g that the prophet says has eyes but cannot see, has ears but cannot hear. Depending on what kind of idol you got, may have some legs. Praise God. May have some arms, but the legs don't work and the arms can't touch. An idol is a false representation of the true thing that we need. And how many of you know, as human beings, we are easily given to idols? One might say we are wired for idolatry. We are wired to worship things that have not yet proven worthy of our worship. And what is worship? Worship is to give something value, to put your dependence in that thing. You see, part of what I find is so important for us in this moment is to make sure that as we strive to make Christ known, that we are lifting up that which not only is accessible to folks, but that which will transform the very being of those who are looking for God. And understand this, everybody's looking for God. Everybody's looking for something, praise God. They may not call it God, some folks looking for love, praise God. I remember watching Eddie Murphy, Buckwheat, what that was his name? Talking about looking no love, and no, that's some of us, right? We looking, praise God. I'm just trying to tell you, man. Looking, and you're trying to find things, and then you get it, but then many of us, we don't know that what we were looking for was the wrong thing until we got it. And I'm here to tell you, why spend all your time wasting looking for the wrong thing when we can tell you up front what you can find that will actually quench and meet your need? Amen. Tell your neighbor, I ain't got no time to waste, praise God. I only got 78, 90 years. So I say amen. And the way how hard some of us live, we cut days off that every day. So you really ain't got no time to waste. Us. because how many know there's a lot of competition for what lives inside of us? That flesh is just living. Somebody say amen. And it's living hard, praise God. That flesh don't ever want to die. And when I say flesh, I'm talking about them desires that you know are not leading you into a wonderful expression of who God is. That flesh is always trying to promote me. Flesh is always trying to make me think that I'm the answer to my problems. I can just get myself together and everything will be all right. And if you can get yourself together, then everything will be all right. But how many of you know there ain't enough getting right? That will solve our problems if Christ is not amplified. Somebody say amen. And this is why I love this passage, because, you know, you got Paul and you got Silas, you got Timothy, you got these fellas, and they running around, they just had experience with Jesus, and they didn't know much except for their experience. But they were so moved and convinced by their experience that they were compelled to go from city to city, place to place, person to person, experience to experience, and make Christ known. They made Christ known through their successes, and they made Christ known through their failures. So be careful. Some of us feel like, well, unless I do everything right, Christ can't be made known. But how many know, even when you fall, Christ has a way of making himself known? Yeah. How is that, Pastor? Well, who you think picked you up again? Oh, you ain't picking yourself up. Some folks say, you got to pull yourself up by your own bootstraps. How many know your bootstraps ain't long enough? Anybody here believe that if it had not been for God on your side?
Yeah.
Amen. Jacked up, right? So that's God. And Paul and Silas and Timothy, as you read this chapter, are engaging in ministry, and they got kicked out of three cities because they were so bold about making Christ known. And this kind of boldness and audacity became so compelling that people began to ask them questions about what does this mean? And let's be clear, I already mentioned how this was a risky thing, right? Because all of these folk found themselves always persecuted. Why? Because the religious sensibility during this time was not a radically monotheistic one, meaning that they did not expect everyone to worship one God. Roman Empire would go out throughout the region, and they would conquer every single nation they could. And their only condition was, you must pay taxes to Caesar. You pay taxes to Caesar, you can worship whoever you want to. All right? And the way that they accomplished this is that they were called pagans. Now, to be a pagan was not to be someone who didn't worship Yahweh or Adonai or Elohim or Jesus or the Christian God, but to be a pagan in that time was anyone who only worshiped one God. So you see the difference in this kind of sensibility? That in this time, if you only worship one God, you were a threat to the Roman Empire. Because they realized that as long as you're worshiping a whole lot of things and you give me my money, then guess what? I got your full loyalty. But as soon as somebody else gets your full loyalty, then we're going to have some problems. And don't you know that's what the problem with empire is? That's the problem with, you know, a radical kind of political nation-state ideology, that everything's okay until you start upsetting the apple cart. Until you start saying, well, this is not the way of God. We were in New Orleans, and I was doing a workshop, and I said that a prophet is never a prophet if the king feels good about what the prophet has to say. Man, we need more prophets in this country, praise God. We need prophets to tell, you know, some of our folk in these positions of power, amen, that war is not the answer. That money to the top 1% is not the answer. That, you know, disinvesting in communities is not the answer. That privatizing prisons is not the answer. That all of these kind of issues that make and diminish people's humanity and dignity is not the answer. Because how do you know that we are created in the image of God? And the prophet is always proclaiming restoration. generation. And here you have these individuals, so moved by the message of Jesus, moving out throughout the place, making Christ known. And Paul ran out of town, shows up to another town, and he is now in a place where they are understanding you've got a different message than everybody else. And couldn't it be fascinating if your message, your strategy, your developed skill set of making Christ known stood out so much in your family, your neighborhood, and your community that folks were always intrigued about what you have to say? Understand this, child of God. Making Christ known is not always about proclaiming it to people you don't know. But it's proclaiming to the people God puts around you every single day. And if you and I can take care of making Christ known to people that God puts around us every single day, how many know there ain't nobody around that will never not know who God is? Give your neighbor one more high five and tell them, make Christ known, make Christ known. So, four ways to make Christ known that I think the scriptures lift up that I'd love to amplify for us today as we work through this passage. The first way that I think that you and I can learn to make Christ known as an act of revolutionary living is through the power of our relationships. Somebody holler relationships. Now, you see in the book of Acts, chapter 17, 16 that we read, that Paul is making his way through cities, from city, city to city, person to person, and he is engaging with folk, both Christians and non-Christian alike. And isn't it interesting that as Paul engages with folk, folk don't leave Paul, but folk go deeper with Paul. Paul is not compromising what Paul has to say, but Paul is presenting this so powerfully that people are arrested, they are intrigued by his presentation. Could it be that the way you and I make Christ known is through how we build healthy relationships? Now, how many of you know it's easy to love folk that you like? Well, let me say easier to love folk who look like you, who have your same skin tone, who have the same, you know, favorite sports teams. Go 49ers, praise God. who have your same political ideology and have your vision of the world. How many know it's easy to love those folk? Yeah. It's easier to love those folk who have not did anything wrong to you. Somebody say amen. Yeah. It's easy to love those folk who live in the same part of the neighborhood, town as you. Somebody say amen. Yeah. Teach us how to build relationships that are grounded in love is one of the greatest examples though it can be a piece of work. But that's okay, because we are human beings. And anyone that may try to make you feel bad because you're a Christian, because you're a piece of work, just tell them you're a piece of work too, and you ain't even a Christian. Ain't wrestling. It ain't about being a Christian or being a non-Christian is engaging you being a piece of work. We are followers of Jesus. They acknowledge that if God is not at work in us, we can never be the kind of human being that we are called to be. So, I always tell folks that people want to know that you care before they care what you know. So some of the reasons that relationships fail so often is because we have not demonstrated our ability to care. I was reading this article, I shared this with our leaders, I'm gonna share this with you real quick, as 10 things I believe Christians should say, and I want you to practice all 10 of these this week. You should write these down, tweet them, take Instagram, pop them up on your Facebook page, text it, do whatever you got to do. But this will help you have better relationships. The first thing every Christian should say is, I'm sorry. Let's practice, everybody say it. Some people laughing and like, you laugh to keep from crying, pretty bad. But don't you know that every Christian should never have a problem saying, I'm sorry? Why? Because God forgives you. And if God forgives you, why can't you forgive nobody else? I'm sorry. Second thing, how can I help? You say that this week. Come on, practice it. How many of you know some folks that need your help? All right? And if you don't, God will bring somebody across you. And I'm talking about a one way to make Christ known in your relationship. How can I help? Second thing, I don't know. Come on, practice that. You don't got to be a know-it-all, praise God. Have you ever met anyone that felt like that? They actually like sat at the feet of God himself and got like all the answers to every problem in the universe. But some of us just need to learn how to say a good, I don't know. Yeah. All right? And be okay with not knowing everything. Don't you know that your ability or tendency to feel like you know it all is a sign of pride and arrogance? Mm-hmm. Fourth thing, I could be wrong. Come on, everybody.
I could be wrong.
You ought to practice that this week. Offer your opinions with great humility. And in it, I don't know, I could be wrong. Open yourself up that you may not have the right answer all the time. Even if you know you do, open up the possibility to build better relationships. Oh, I got another one. What do you think? What do you think? That's a question. Every Christian should be curious. Everybody say that. What do you think? Come on, practice that.
What do you think?
Yeah, do it right, you know. What do you think? What do you think? You know, put a little tinge, you know, uptick on it. What do you think? Here's a good one. I love you. Come on, everybody, say that. Now, let me tell you why this is so important. Because most people have never had love like the love of God. When I used to work at the school, I used to stand at the front, and every time the young students would come in, whether they were late or on time, I'd be like, hey, I love you, young fella, welcome to school. Feel, man, you a pervert or something? What you talking about? Like, no, I'm not a pervert, man. I'm just telling you I love you. You know what I mean? Come on, superstar, let's get to class. After a while, they got used not only to me telling them I love them, but to me showing it. And how many of you know some folk have never received the genuine love of God? And that they are always suspicious of anyone who not only tell them that they love them, but show them that they love them. But if you're going to have a great relationship, you must love in word and deed. That means what you say and what you do. But if you love folk, how many of you know love covers a multitude of sin? Everybody say, I love you.
I love you.
All right, I got four more. The next one says, tell me more. Don't you be talking so much and people can't ever get an egg, you know. Tell me more. I want to hear more. Listen. Every Christian ought to listen this week. The Bible says slow to speak.
Yes.
Quick to listen. Slow to wrath. Come on, everybody practice. Tell me more. Say that.
Tell me more.
All right, here's another one. That just sucks.
That just sucks.
It's okay to say that in church. Come on, say that. That just sucks. Now, that is a gesture towards being empathetic. Sometimes you gotta enter into the pain with people and acknowledge that people are hurting. Being able to not be so quick to solve their problem, but rather to be with them in their problem. Slow it down. That just said, last one, let's give it a try. Come on, everybody.
Let's give it a try.
It was a great try. This week, welcome. Let's give it a try. And the last thing is, say nothing at all. Some of us just talk too much. Rather than trying to say anything, some of us just need to be silent with folks. You know what, I've been hurting so much that you didn't need no words, you just needed someone just to sit there with you. And just, maybe you say, man, that sucks. I mean, you just sit there. Just say nothing at all. Let's practice that for a second. Good job. 10 things that I believe if you did this week, it would enhance your relationships. And how many of you know Ephesians 4, 31, 32, you should write this down, memorize it. It says, put away from you all bitterness, wrath, and anger, railing, and slander, together with all malice. Listen, and be kind to one another. Tenderhearted, forgiving one another as God in Christ has forgiven you. Child of God, if God can be in relationship with folk like us, how many of you know we ought to do everything we can to be in relationship with any and everybody else? Give your neighbor a high five and tell them relationships, relationships, relationships. The second thing, the way that I believe you can make Christ known and we can make Christ known is through our worship. Somebody say worship.
Worship.
Now, when I talk about worship, I'm not talking about the 30 minutes or so at the beginning of service that Pastor Eric Claibon and the worship team leads us every week. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about the way you live every day is an act of worship. Here in this story, Paul walks through the city and he sees the objects that are there as people's worship. And how many of you know that who you worship and how you worship will always be a great indication of what you are worshiping? That these idols are a demonstration to Paul about who they were worshiping. And how many of you know that God does not call you and I to set up idols, but God calls you and I to be objects of worship, that your lifestyle is worship. And I'm not talking about you running around singing, Lord, you are good and your mercy. You just walk down the street on your job. I'm not saying that that's what we're calling you to do. Did you travel with a drum set in your pocket and a Hammond organ in your backpack and you just worshiping all day? How can that's not what I'm talking about? Romans 12 verse 1 says it like this, that I beg you, my brothers and sisters, to present your body as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable act of worship. That to worship God is about how you live every single day. It's not about what you do in church. It's about what you do when you leave the church. And you make Christ known to people around you by how you live as an act of worship. And how many of you know that when you are living every single day a life that is a life of worship to God, when you show up to church on Sunday morning, worship is an easy thing to participate in. Because you are doing or continuing what you've been doing all week. Some of us come to church, it's so hard to get involved in worship because that's the first time we did any worship to God all week. So we leave church and we worship in everything but God. You gotta come in, you gotta dig real deep. You gotta do a deep cleansing, praise God, you know. You gotta pull your broom and your shovel and your, you know, that jackhammer. You just gotta get all that stuff from on top of the worship see Jesus inside of us. So we are worship life. Every time we go outside, we are an act of worship. And hear me on this. Human beings build idols to worship and then bring themselves glory. But God has created and saved you and I to bring Him glory. You see the difference there? Human beings build idols so they can get glory. But God creates us so we can give God the glory. How many of you know God deserves all of the glory and all of the praise? How you live and how you worship God, the way you love folk, the decisions you make, that is an act of worship. And living in this region when everybody, you know, is suspicious about Jesus, we need your billboard on blast 24/7. I wish I had a church in the end of the day. Amen. We don't need you like, you know, Monday you sing and worship God, and then Tuesday you taking the day off. Wednesday you're in witness protection program. Thursday you're trying to find your way back out. Friday you trip, fall yourself, you know, then Sunday is like, whoo, thank God I made it to church. Wow. No, that's not helping nobody. Because how many know folk don't come to church to be God? Folk run into you to meet God. That's the divine plan. Ain't something in the scriptures, most of the people that met God outside of the temple. It's quiet in here. I'm like, what you talking about, Pastor? I bring folks here so you can talk to them. No, no, no. I can talk to them, but guess what? I'm not there to talk to them like you are. Greatest numbers so quickly in these times was not great preaching. They didn't even have the Bible written yet, because they writing it right now. You know, Acts wasn't written in the time of Acts. You know, like, yes, the Bible just didn't like fall out of the sky. I am the Bible. But it didn't happen like that. Records show that the early believers, once they were being rounded up by the Roman Empire to be killed for being worshiping only Jesus kind of folk, they were put in coliseums to be fed to the lions and tigers and all of these wild beasts. And they were put in these coliseums with other kinds of gladiators. And while these gladiators running around trying to save themselves and fighting off these beasts and being in the middle of the Colosseum, they would dress up in wedding clothes because they knew they were the bride of Christ. And they would sing and praise God while these wild beasts would rip the flesh off of their bodies, because they believed so much that their worship of God and the power of resurrection was more powerful than the threats of the Roman Empire. And people sitting in the Colosseum would look at all these gladiators and be like, wow, you know, man, that lion got the best of them. But they would look at these Christians and they would say, what manner of courage is that? That these folk, in the face of their hardest, most difficult time, would worship God, their God. And they became so curious about this that they began to inquire, and many of these Roman and Greek and others converted to the way of Jesus by the power of these disciples' worship lifestyle. That's why I'm convinced today that more than people need all your highfalutin philosophies, they just need a life lived well. That's how you make Christ known. Living your life well in front of other folk. Pat yourself on the chest and say, I need to live a lifestyle of worship. I need to live a lifestyle of worship. No, let me hasten here. God, I'm just long-winded today. Theology. Somebody say theology. Theology is another way that Christ is made known in this passage, because Paul, a master theologian, was able to take what he knew about God Christians incapable of faith-filled acts. Bad theology produces weak Christians incapable of faith-filled acts. Paul was able, because of his great theology and understanding of what he knew and believed, to take that and embed it in his culture and time and use it as a bridge and pathway to make Christ known. Some of us need to spend more time in our word, in our live groups, spend time hanging out with other folk who can help teach us the word of God, and not spend so much time in our gossip groups, in our smoking groups, in our clubbing groups, that when we gotta think about our theology, we don't know what to say, because the last thing that's on your mind is Weezy's song from last night. Mm-hmm. Yo, your Swisher and your puff puff passing and all that other stuff is all in your mind, and you ain't got nowhere for theology or the ways of God to come out.
Yeah.
I'm not trying to be a hater, sort of, kind of. I'm just trying to tell you that not everything fits in your head. Many of us drink from too many wells, and that's why we always so thirsty. Designed to quench your thirst. You know, you go to restaurants, they're always trying to give you soda. Soda, 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 soda. How many know soda was not designed to quench your thirst? All that salt and all that sugar. Praise God. Somebody bring me some soda.
Yesterday. People need to know that story. People need
the work that God is doing in your life. And when you make Christ known, my experience has always been people want facts. People want healing. People want victory and power and deliverance. People want to be redeemed and get a second chance. People want to be taken to another place than where they are today. People want to have purpose and fulfillment. People want to know that they will never be defined by the worst thing they've done in their life. People want to know that even when they fall, a righteous man gets up again and again and again. Why? Because God is lifting them up every single time. People want to know that story. What I love about Paul is that Paul was taken in front of the Areopagus, in front of the civic center, the synod of that day, and all Paul did was tell them the story of Jesus and what Jesus had did in his life. And I want to let you know that that story still works. It still works. Make Christ known this week. Make it your priority to proclaim Christ. And I guarantee you that as you proclaim Christ, Christ will reveal Christ's self even more to you. Stand with me, everyone, as let us prepare to pray.